everybody. Dr. Bass, appreciate the opportunity to come speak. That's the first time as a former baseball player I've ever been told I'm smart, so I thank you for that. Again, my name is Matt Baty. My official title is kind of long, but it's the Associate Athletic Director for Williams Education Fund, Marketing and Sales. So ultimately, my responsibility at the University of Kansas is to oversee our revenue side. So typical structure of an athletic department is you're gonna have your internal, kind of counts the money. I'm not good at counting, I'm good at bringing money in. So you have the internal side, you have an SWA, you have compliance, and then you have the revenue side, the external side. So typically we can talk about six or seven things, but there's about four things that really we concentrate on bringing revenue in. And that is obviously donations. We have ticket sales, we have sponsorships, and we have licensing. So I oversee two of those four areas. We outsource through IMG our sponsorship side, and then we have a licensing department that reports up to another associate AD. So truly grateful and honored to come speak to you guys today. You're gonna learn a little bit about myself, my passion for college athletics, why I do what I do. You're gonna learn a little bit about what we do at Kansas Athletics. I'll draw back on some of the things that I learned at Wichita State, the Big 12 Conference, some of those things, and where I think the direction of conference realignment's going, where I think we're going and heading. So I'm excited to talk to you guys. At any point, if you guys have a question, please raise your hand, holler at me. I'd love to answer your questions because it's gonna be a lot more fun and entertaining if you're asking questions. So. I first graduate, actually from Wichita, Kansas, born and raised, went to Mays High School. Any Wichitans in here? Okay, good. Any Mays High grads?
I'm Mays High, Mays South.
All right, that was before the split that I went. I graduated in 2002, was fortunate enough to receive a baseball scholarship to come here to the University of Kansas. Played 4 years, four-year starter. Had a career-ending injury, lacerated my spleen and my kidney in a collision, tore my ACL, my meniscus, kind of beat up. And at that point, I made it back with about 6 weeks left in the season. Had a great 6 weeks. We went to the NCAA tournament, ran into Oregon State, which was the defending national championship, and they go on and win the national championship again for back-to-back. So we had a pretty good year. We won Big 12 tournaments that year. Pretty successful team. Had about 15 guys on the team drafted. I was not one of them. Had some opportunities to go play pro ball, decided I wanted to go chase my dream in college athletics. Needed my internship, as many of you guys will learn, needed my internship to graduate. I was fortunate enough to go work at the Big 12 Conference, got in Dallas. Worked for Associate Commissioner Tim Allen, which was one of my dear friends to this day, one of my mentors. I'm super, super grateful for the relationship that I have with him. Through that, I was helped him out with championships on the men's side. So I helped out with men's basketball, football, and baseball, the three main revenue sports for the conference. So I helped put on the event. I was the floor manager, kind of helped structure the tournament. And then I also helped him out with TV scheduling. And so as he's working through the schedules, we would compare schedules, Big 12 football schedules, and all those things. At one point, I used to have a document, so I could tell you, people were always talking about it's not out public. This is the last year that I could have told everybody what their schedules were gonna be in the Big 12, and that's back in, from 2006. So that's how far you're working on those schedules. There are some changes, but some of those contracts are written 10 years in advance. So I got some great experience there. One of the jobs that I would do is I would literally sit on a Saturday morning, and I would have a stopwatch. And I would time commercials. And then we'd be on the phone with the network saying, now you went over 15 seconds. So we're trying to keep them accountable, try to speed up the game. And they're trying to do more and more of that every year, is trying to speed up the game. So that was a great experience of mine. I draw back on that because for the last probably 9 years, I've been the floor manager for first and second round. I've had a Sweet 16, I've had a Final Four. I've gotten to do some pretty cool stuff with both the Missouri Valley and the Big 12 Conference. as far as being a host for men's basketball tournaments. So I still get to do that. This was the first year that I didn't get to do it just because of my new role now and what I do. I wouldn't have the time to be able to do that. After I graduated, got my internship done at the Big 12 Conference, I was fortunate enough to get a job. Lou Perkins called me, offered me a job in marketing here at the University of Kansas. Did that for about 3 years, putting on the kind of the fan experience side. And that was really the first moment where, as a student athlete, you think about just showing up at the game. You know, you get it on the schedule. Coach tells you, sandwiches at 3 o'clock, VP at 4 o'clock. You show up and you play. When I got into marketing, I realized that there's a lot more to a baseball game or a basketball game than just showing up as a student athlete. There's a lot of things that go into it as far as preparing for it. A year in advance, you're building the marketing plans, you're trying to get the groups there, you're trying to create the environment for student athletes, you know, fan support, winning tradition, those type of things that you're trying to help with. So that was the first time that I really got to see that side of it outside of the conference side. And so I fell in love with athletics at that point. I was fortunate enough at that point to be offered a director of development job back home at Wichita State. Within a year, my boss left, and I got promoted to assistant athletic director, which was one of the best experiences of my life. Never managed a staff, ever. Okay? You have a small budget that you're working with. About $5 million annually is what we brought in on our SESO student. I can't remember what it's called anymore. SESO. And so you got to see that you had to work for every single penny at the mid-major level. And that was exciting. So I had a small staff, had to work for every penny, and got to really do some things that you get to when you get to a bigger school, you get to hide behind because you got bigger budgets. So we had to grind for every single penny that we had, which was a great experience for me. You know, one thing at Wichita State, everybody's familiar with Greg Marshall, and he's a dear friend of mine. At that level, 90% of what I did as a leader of the development department, fundraising department, was raise his salary. So we would raise 1.2, 1.4 million, 1.7 million a year just for his salary. And so the difference between here and there, that's the big difference. We're not going out and raising specifically for their self-salary like we were with Greg Marshall, to be able to afford a guy like Greg Marshall. So that was kind of exciting to be able to do that. I always laugh. I probably have a good relationship with Coach Marshall because I helped make him a billionaire. So he tends to like me a little bit because he's got money in his pocket. So we have a great relationship. Lynn Marshall, everybody's seen that crazy stuff that's on social media and everything about Greg Marshall. Greg Marshall and Lynn Marshall are two of my favorite people in the world. And they're just very, very passionate. And that's what I love about them. So after that, I started really thinking about, praying about, talking to my wife about what's my next step. And to be an athletic director, as you'll learn, you tend to have to move around. I wanted to be an athletic director, but I knew nothing about business. And everybody that's in economics and business classes, you quickly learn that when you have a life in athletics, one thing that's lacking is the thought of business, how to run a business, how to do those things. So I knew nothing about a P&L, right? Profit loss sheet, okay? I couldn't spell P&L. So I knew nothing about it. So I wanted to go get some experience. And at that point, when you start off in sports, they say, once you get out of sports, it's going to be very tough to get back in. And that's true. Honest to God, the truth. But as you've seen, these athletic directors now are starting to come out of areas that they're getting business experience. And so I wanted to do that. I challenged myself and I said, hey, I set kind of a 7 to 8 year plan to get back in athletics. And I made a jump and I got out and went into banking. And I oversaw all business development for a bank in Wichita. It was a regional bank. I traveled a lot. Got to learn as a banker, you got to learn good business, you got to learn bad business. You got to see some companies go through bankruptcy, You got to see some companies flourish. And so I really got to learn that. And we were an acquiring bank, so we went out and acquired troubled banks. And so I would get out ahead of the acquisition and go meet with clients and try to salvage the relationship. So we'd go into small community markets. I'd get out, sit down with a client and say, hey, this is why you need to stay with Equity Bank. When we transition from whatever bank, Bank A, that we're now going to be Bank B, I need you to stick with us, and this is why. And so that was a fun part of my job. Loved every minute of it. And then when I was in at your guys' age, this was about 14 years ago, I started working on a business plan. A business plan to open up my own multi-sports facility in Wichita. And something I always wanted to do, being a baseball guy, I wanted my own baseball academy. And something I always wanted to do. Well, how I got to know the CEO of the bank is I was sitting in his office one day with a business plan trying to go get financing. And it's because it was something I always wanted to do. And he's sitting there working through, and as I'm handing the business plan that he's helping me develop, I see in the paper that Good Sports in Wichita, they're actually a company out of Florida, was just now coming into Wichita, and they just got $5.5 million worth of star bonds and all this. I remember at that point, that's when I threw my plans in the trash, and I started having a conversation about getting out of athletics and getting into banking and learning the business side. So, flash forward 3 years later, as I'm sitting in the bank, I get a phone call from a dear friend, and he says, hey, I know this is a passion of yours. You want to open up an indoor multi-sports facility? The Good Sports project is failing. He can't get funding, he can't get financing on his hotel, so therefore he can't do it. We have an opportunity to take over the project. I jumped at it, two feet in, and for about 17 months, we built, in 6 months and one day, we built 150,000 square foot multi-sports facility in Wichita. It was tilt up, concrete, building. Guys, you can't build a house in 6 months in one day, and we built 150,000 square feet, which was fun, because that was the first time that I was ever a part of a construction process. So we built that in Wichita, which didn't probably know the Wichita Sports Forum. It had a 30,000 square foot trampoline park. It had 6 basketball courts, 10 volleyball courts, 6 indoor sand volleyball courts, had a soccer field, 8 batting cages, and it was the cool deal in Wichita, still is. And then now we're flashing forward 14, 17 months in, whatever it was, I get a phone call from a dear friend, and Sean Lester is the deputy AD here. It says, Banks Fludman's leaving. Okay, the football guys in this group knows who Banks Fludman is. Okay, Banks Fludman was a stud linebacker here that oversaw the Williams Fund here. Said he was leaving, going into the private sector, needed somebody to lead the department. Would I be interested, and would I be able to talk to Dr. Zager? Over the next 4 months, I had an interview process. Over the next 4 months, it was the most grueling interview process, ups and downs, that I've ever went through. But I knew I wanted to get back in athletics. I knew I wanted to be on the external side. I knew I wanted to lead the revenue department at the University of Kansas. So now here I am today, 9 months in, and I'm having the time of my life. I have 3 kids. I have 7-year-old twins, boy, girl. And then I have a 3-year-old son. My wife stays at home with the last one until he's ready to go off to school. And my wife is a former athlete here at the University of Kansas. She was a rower for University of Kansas. And so she was one of those that was a walk-on that walked up on campus. And that's how generally the recruiting and rowing works at the collegiate level. When you don't have rowing per se in the state of Kansas or even the Midwest, the high school level that's starting to develop, they do a lot of their recruiting on campus. And so my wife, being tall, being 6 foot and broad shoulders, she had the opportunity to get a full ride scholarship to be a rower here, which was kind of cool. And so she got her tuition paid for, and that was a fun little project. So that's our counter sport to what football is. And so football, with having 86 or 85, whatever it is, full ride scholarships, you have to counter that with Title IX and things like that. So we have some cool things going on. One of the things that you, when you're the new guy coming in, you know, and I recommend this for anybody that's going out and getting a new job and being the leader, is to really set back for the first 6 months and really analyze where you are, who do you have on your team, what have we done, what can we do better, what would you do when you come in charge? And I really looked at that as the first 6 months of really being in a transition and not really being in charge. And I sat back, I took 20 pages of notes of how we do things, what would I do when I do become in charge. And at my 6 month date, I called an all staff meeting with my immediate staff and I shared with them. I said, we got great staff. We got tenured staff. We got people that have been here for 13, 14, 15, 25 years. That's great. Okay? We have experience over those years. We have, over those years, we got experience. People have been through thick and thin. We went through a ticket scandal. We went through wins and losses. We went through Final Fours. We went through bowl games. We've done all this. We have all this experience. But what does that lead to? It leads to status quo. It leads to complacency if you're not careful. And so my job over the next 6 months is really to challenge that status quo and that complacency and that entitlement that we have in the athletic department that every business has. And so my challenge over the next 6 months is to do that. So we're introducing a lot of new things to our donor base, which is a challenge. I remember sitting in a staff meeting and we're making some changes to our priority point system. I remember one of my staff members looking over to me and she goes, this is going to be a shit show, okay? She said, this is going to be a shit show. I go, okay, I'm all about words, right? Words to me are important, okay? So you say this is a shit show. Let's go back to when we first introduced the Priority Point program, which was 14 years ago. When we first introduced that, was that a shit show? Oh, yeah, that was a shit show, okay? So then we asked, okay, well, then you went 5-6 later, years later, you went through a ticket scandal. Was that a shit show? Oh, yeah, that's the worst thing we've ever went through here. Okay, so this little change over here, after looking at those two, is that a shit show? No, you're right. This isn't that bad. So the changes that we're making is really starting to drive our annual dollar. Okay, I sat in the office yesterday with a donor of mine, and he's steaming. He's steaming. He gives us $5,000 a year, and he's steaming at me because he thinks the changes in the Williams Fund is going to affect his long-term and loyalty in giving. And I disagree with that. And so we had an honest-to-God conversation. I'm going to kind of flash back and forth of telling you where our current point system is. So our current point system is really based on you get 1 point per $100 that you give to the annual fund. And then you get all sorts of points for being longtime season ticket holders. You get points for being an alum. You get points for being in the K Club. You get points for being all sorts of things, which are great things, great loyalty things. So how we do our reseeding in Allen Fieldhouse and at Memorial Stadium and all of our sports is all based on priority points. Okay? It's all based on total points. So you can have somebody that's given $50,000 a year, which we have 168 of those, okay? We have $168 to get $50,000 a year. It's unbelievable. It's really impressive, okay? So we have all of that, and then you have some donors that have great seats in our field house sitting mid-court, maybe, that might be only giving $5,000 a year, giving $10,000 a year, because they went through the point system and figured out and played the game that we created 14 years ago, but they developed points, okay? Or they gave a ton of money 10 to 15 years ago, which is great. We appreciate that, and we still incorporate that in our point system. But our big change that we're making, which is our postseason model, we travel unbelievable. When we went to New York, we travel better than anybody. Duke, Kentucky, North Carolina, anybody. You put them up, our fan base against them, we travel better than them. And so we had to put some limitations on how many tickets you can get on the road, who qualifies for tickets. So our model on the postseason, it's always been this, is it's all based on annual dollar, so your level. So we have a level that goes from $100 all the way to $50,000. We have 15 levels in between, okay? So it's all based on our Hall of Fame levels are $50,000 donors. So they get access to tickets before the next level. Makes sense, right? You're getting $50,000, you should get access to tickets over probably somebody that's getting five. So I'm sitting in the office one day and we start talking about how are we gonna change it? We've been stuck at $19.5 million on our annual fund for the last 3 to 4 years, okay? And a lot of people say, man, that's a lot of money. And it is a ton of money, okay? But as a guy that's in charge of revenue, we've been stuck at $19.5 million, and we all know when football gets going, that number's gonna skyrocket for us, okay? But with basketball, we've kind of hit, I would argue, we've hit that peak. We go win a national championship in our current model, our number doesn't move. We're stuck at $19.5 million, okay? So my goal and what I'm trying to change the status quo model is how can we get to $25 million? How can we get to $30 million? That's what I want to challenge my staff, okay? So we're changing our model and our priority point and how we receipt is based on our postseason model. So it's somebody that gives $50,000, it's going to seat before 25, before 10, before 5, before 2, or 2,500, before 100, okay? In my model, that makes sense. Being a business guy, that makes sense. So I'm sitting across from a gentleman yesterday, and he tells me he owns a couple businesses here in town and throughout the Midwest. And he tells me, well, you know, you're really screwing me over on the loyalty. And I said, how am I screwing you over on the loyalty? And he says, well, I've been given $5,000 for the last 10 years, blah, blah, blah. And I said, okay. I asked him a question. I said, how do you run your business? How do you pay your current bills? And he goes, well, I pay my current bills with current revenue. I said, okay, so how come we aren't any different? Why do we not get that opportunity to pay our bills on current money? So I asked him again, I said, do you pay your bills on money that you raised 10 years ago? No, I don't. I pay my bills on money that I raise now. Okay, that's exactly the same with us. Is we are now going to a model of paying our current bills when they're due, okay? So the whole idea is if you bring in $98 million in the athletic department, your idea is to spend $98 million. The only way that you grow revenue is by doing things like this to grow revenue and winning. Winning helps, right? Winning helps. And we believe that football is really going to get us there and get us over that $100 million mark is when we can get football going, which they're well on their way, okay? So we're kind of changing our model and our philosophy that we're really driven on annual dollar. So points still matter within level, okay? So it's better to be a new $50,000 donor at the bottom level of a $50,000 donor than being a $25,000 donor on the high side or on the low side, okay? So we're really driving people to go to the next level is what we got to try to do. Now, are there some people that are going to be upset with this process and this change? Absolutely. Absolutely. Okay? But it's all about being able to put stuff out there that people can see and be transparent on. And we now finally have a model that's transparent. We're not what we've done in the past with tickets. We've hoarded out tickets. Okay? When in 2008, I remember in 2009 when I was here, we went out with a ticket bonus. If you bought season tickets for football, we gave you 25 bonus points per ticket, and it went crazy. And people bought 300 season tickets so they can get that 25 point bonus per ticket, okay? And so we really hoard out a point system for a long time. And so now we have a transparent process for people to jump into our point game. And we now have a model that can go after new money. We never had that model, okay? Our model of new money is if you give me $50,000, you're gonna ask, what do you want? You guys discussed this. It's a transactional business now, right? So if you give me $50,000, you want what? Good seats, right? You want great seats. Well, in our current model, you give us $50,000, guess where you're sitting? Way up top in Allen Field House. Now, football, we can spread those tickets out so you get great seats. And until we get good, we'll get there and be able to drive people, $50,000 donors, to get football seats. Okay? But right now, our number one revenue driver is our men's basketball program and people driving revenue towards that with better seats. It's transactional, okay? I don't like it. I don't like the transactional business, but that's the model that we've created with the point system. We created that 14 years ago, and we have been the poster child for all of programs around the country modeling their point system after us. And it's pretty cool. But just like everything, all good things come to an end, we need to change some things. We need to drive some things. We're maxed out at $19.5 million, and we got to drive it. Guess what happens? It's a trickle-down effect, right? John Calipari, what did he get? He just got a raise, right? Okay? What do you think our coaching staff's going to be asking for? A raise, right? I would argue, yeah, he deserves it. He's won 13 Big 12 championships in a row, okay? The crazies out there would say, oh, he doesn't deserve it because he hadn't won a national championship. That's BS, okay? He has won 13 Big 12 championships in a row. He deserves anything, okay? So that's our job. So what do you think, how do you think we're going to raise those additional dollars? Through fundraising efforts, okay? The other thing is we're getting $2 million every time the Big 12, every time the Sugar Bowl hosts the national championship, we get $2 million less from the Big 12 Conference. $2 million is a lot of money, okay? It's a lot of money that we're missing every time the Sugar Bowl. So in 2017, coming up, Sugar Bowl will be hosting the national championship game, and we'll get $2 million less. So Average Joe fan doesn't see those numbers, but we have to find $2 million somewhere, right? We're pulling that money from our coffers. We don't have a savings account. We spend every dollar that we receive. So we have less money coming in, so we got to drive it in other avenues. And so that's the reasons why we're making some changes. Now, we're not making that change. We, just like you should, we're doing, in 2017, we're having our same model. This model is going in effect in 2018 for the football season of 2018. This model will go in effect. So we're giving everybody a chance to understand the point system. It gives us a chance to kind of breathe and say, okay, is there some adjustments we can make on loyalty? Or are there some things that we can do to really help individuals out and really take to heart the loyalty that these guys have done for 35 years being a season ticket holder and things like that? So is it done? Is the model done? Probably not. We're trying to tweak it a little bit, see if we can make some people happy and do those things. So that's kind of the stuff that I deal with on a day-to-day basis, not to mention go out and raise capital for projects. We just landed a big $10 million gift for a facility that we're going to tear down and rebuild. We're working on a $6 million gift for hopefully baseball that we can reconstruct Hogan Ballpark and do some stuff like that. And then we got the fun project. The project that I came to work here for is Memorial Stadium. Okay? Memorial Stadium, these football guys here tell you, we got some pretty cool stuff down in the locker room, okay? We got some really cool stuff. Got an unbelievable coaching staff, okay? One of the best in the country, some of the best recruiters. It's time for us to step up and provide, okay? And I think we started doing that with the locker room and doing those things. But now we got Memorial Stadium, okay? You got this aging beauty over here. That's the oldest stadium west of the Mississippi, and it's costing us $1 million a year just to fix her up and do different things and do painting and spray painting and washing and doing all those things. It's costing us a lot of money, okay? So we have to take a look at things of, okay, how can we fund this? Every fundraiser would say we would love the egg first and then the chicken, okay? But we're kind of betting on the come here. We're betting on Coach Baty being the dude for here for a long time. We're betting on these guys and our student athletes to get it done on the gridiron. That's where we're betting. So now we're in the chicken before the egg scenario, which makes it what? Difficult to go fundraise dollars. If you told me we had to go raise $20 million today for men's basketball, it'd be done tomorrow, okay? If you tell me I have to raise $20 million for football right now, it's a challenge, okay? So we have to do some very unique things, okay? So we're working on, we just got done Friday with the architects, and we're trying to finalize all of our plans. We used to have some plans, we didn't like them. Okay? So my challenge is coming in and really challenging our senior team and saying, well, we can do better. We can do better. We can do better. And so right now we're working on a phase scenario. We can do west side, south side scenario, $150 million renovation. How can we connect Memorial to Anderson, the offices? How can we build an indoor sports or indoor training facility over there? How can we do all those things? So that's what we're finalizing with the architects right now. Okay? And that's the fun process. Okay? I'm having more fun today than I've ever had because I get to have a vision. I get to sit down with our athletic director and really talk about what's to come and how can we provide for our student athletes and how can we give our fan base the best in-game environment and experience that we possibly do. Okay? In return, we're going to start doing some fun things in Memorial. We're going to do, we're adding some stuff to our touchdown club. We're getting rid of those clown seats in the north end zone. Okay? I hate those clown seats. I put those clown seats together personally 10 years ago. Okay, and that structure hasn't changed at all. So we're changing that up. We're doing cabana suites out front. Really, what we're trying to do is get our fan base prepared for success, for one, but prepared for a remodel of Memorial where we're going to have in-game entertainment and things like that. So one discussion that we're having now is in our south end zone, what can we do with the worst seats in the house and make those some great seats? Well, that's where we're talking about doing a kind of I get in trouble if I use certain words. I can't call it beer zone. I can't do that. But what we want to provide is an environment for somebody to buy a membership to where they can drink a beer if they want to during the game. So that's the environment that we're trying to steal, the fan experience side that we're doing. Because not only do I oversee the fundraising side, I also oversee the marketing and sales side, the fan experience side. So we're really driving, everything we do is driven around revenue, okay? Driven around revenue. We're probably one of maybe 10 universities that have the structure the way we do, where I oversee marketing and sales along with development, okay? Most guys will see communications and marketing and development as kind of their own little beasts. Well, my philosophy on it is to have marketing and sales along with our development department. Because here's the timeline that we work through. I want you to become a single game ticket buyer, okay? I want you to come and have your birthday party on the hill for a football game. And then I want to develop you, and all of our marketing strategies are developed around making you a single game buyer to become a season ticket holder. Right? And then the next step and all of our marketing after that is directed towards you becoming a donor. Okay? And then all of our marketing is all developed around at that level for you to become a major gift donor. Okay? So there's a timeline for us that we work through. And that's why I really like the structure of the way we do things here is we're developing from the marketing ground up, get them in the door, buying a ticket, buying a group ticket, buying a birthday package, whatever it is, and hopefully work them along the lines to get them to become a donor. And so that's kind of our transition, our lifeline of our fan base is trying to get them to go up there. Our challenge is we got to continue to drive young, youthful donors. We're at 6,000, just under 6,000 donors to the Williams Fund. Okay? Of those 6,000 donors, we bring in roughly in the annual fund, we bring in $19.5 million. And then we bring in probably another $10 million in other things that we do. So let's just say we're at $30 million. Okay? We do that with 6,000 donors. Our friends to the west in purple over there, okay? God bless them. They wear purple. Okay. They have over 10,000 donors. Kick our butts when it comes to the number of donors. Okay? But they don't even come close to the money that we raise. So our top three levels, which is 50, 25, and 10, generate 90% of our revenue on the annual fund side. Okay? That's kind of cool, but it's also kind of scary. Okay? Because we have an aging donor population. We just lost the great Bill Hoagland, okay? Two-time Olympian, gold medalist, national champion here, big former Coke dude, and made a lot of money, okay? He was giving us $50,000 a year, did a lot of other things for this university, and we have to try to find a guy to replace that, okay? So we're constantly searching for the next guy that can come in at $2,500 and work his way up. And that's why that model of us changing our point system and doing things and really driving the annual dollar is really going to help us. We have a ton of people. that refuse to give us a penny because they want better seats, and we can't give them better seats. So we got to drive that revenue and get new bodies in and new dollars in by changing up our point system. Okay? Any questions about that? Of what we do, how we do it, anything on the revenue side? Come on, somebody's got a question. So do like a $75,000 level?
Yeah, or like between the 25 and 50,000.
It's a great question. That's a question that we're asking ourselves every day is, what can we do? So when we first started, I said, oh, that's easy. We have $168. We have people that can give more than $50,000. Why don't we jump it up to a $75,000 level or a $100,000 level? That's a great idea. But what we struggle with, when you have $168, what are the benefits that you can provide these people? Transactional business, right? I wish it was the Bill Hoeklands of the world where we're pulling heartstrings. Or I wish it was, I wish that the mentality was the heartstrings and being on the endowment side where they pull heartstrings to give to the school of education for sports management. That's pulling heartstrings, okay? We do a little bit of that, but ours is so much transactional, okay? It's the beast we've created, all right? So we, with the 168 donors that give $50,000, what do you give them in return for giving $50,000? Okay, well, we take 6 donors on every men's basketball trip. We take 15 donors on every football trip, okay? And then we split them up and do some stuff with women's basketball. We do some stuff with baseball. We do some sport stuff with volleyball and different things like that, okay? But it's driven, the revenue is all driven around men's basketball. Okay? So, say this past year for basketball, we took, I think, 4 trips. In football, we took 4 trips. Math doesn't add up, right? We have 168 donors and we don't have enough benefits to provide them. So you hear, what the group that I feel bad for in our whole process is $10,000, our All-American level. We get $10,000. They get $10,000. I can't give $10,000. Can you give $10,000? I can't. So I feel bad for that group because our giving level, our benefits, we kind of missed the bar with the $10,000 level. And then we kind of get a little bit better with 25, and we kind of get a little bit better with 50. But what can you provide? Just open practice time so we can get everybody there. They want to get on trips. They want to fly with the team. They want to do those things. So it's tough benefit-wise to do that. So we're trying to play with, okay, we have a big gap between 10 and 25. Can we add a 15,000? Can we add a 17,000? The other idea that we have, and this is the idea that I kind of stole from Wichita State because this model works, is what about, we haven't, what's crazy about this is our giving level, I think we added the $50,000 level maybe 8 years ago, maybe 4 years ago, I don't know, I wasn't here. So, but let's just say for a safe example, a $10,000 donor. Our $10,000 minimum, there's not a lot of people that give more than, if you qualify for that level, you don't go $10,200, you get $10,000. Well, that $10,000 that you've been given for the last 10 years, you're actually giving us less money in today's standard than you did 10 years ago, right? Inflation, 3%, whatever it is, you're giving us less money. So that's the other argument of why we need to change our point system. But to try to change that is, can we take our minimum levels up every year? Can we do a 3% raise, a cost of living increase for each of our minimum levels? So, you know, do a $10,300 increase, or a $300 increase on $10,000. Can we do things like that to really drive? That's what Wichita State does. They do a percentage increase every year. It's known. If you're a say-so donor, you know that they're going to hit you with a 3-5% increase at every level, and they're going to go 3-5% increase on tickets. So can we go that model? I don't know. We're surely getting less money than we did 4 years ago in our current model if we don't move that. So that, those are the things we're trying to, it's a good question, but those are things we're looking at.
You, So you mentioned that you're trying to add a couple new customer segments with like single game tickets and season ticket holders. Do you think that will make it more difficult to develop more marketing strategies around more customer segments?
So say that again. So we're trying to do more things for our fan base.
It seems like you're trying to add more customer segments with like single game ticket holders, season ticket holders, as well as the donor level that you currently have in your current system. Do you think it's going to be difficult to develop more marketing strategies targeting more consumers?
Yeah, absolutely. The difficult strategy right now is, and everybody is dealing with this, and we're trying to combat it and find ways. I went to lunch or breakfast about a month ago with, I think, a gentleman that you guys met with the Chiefs, the CFO of the Chiefs. I think he's come and spoke. And Dr. Bass, and we're kind of talking about our ticket broker situation, right? We have ticket brokers. Every venue in America has a ticket broker problem. And how do you segment who is a broker? Our average fan is a broker. He's selling tickets on StubHub. So that is the battle when you talk about benefits, when you talk about price, and are you pricing people out and doing those things? You know what our challenge is? Is do we price them out where they just say, you know what, I've been getting $50,000 a year, why don't I just take $25,000, not give anything to Kansas Athletics, and I'll just go pick the 6 to 8 games that I want to go to, and I'm going to go buy my stuff up, right? That's easy to do, right? That's the challenge that we have right now, and every venue has. That's what the Chiefs are going through right now. They're going through a huge problem. The Royals are going through a huge problem on brokers is because they have tickets that are going out on StubHub, and they can go get a ticket for $5 for a Chiefs game on a rainy day, and they can just hold out until the last minute to buy a ticket if they want to go. So that's the battle that we're fighting. Did that kind of answer your question? You know, we're always trying to find unique ways to get people in the building, but you're always challenged with, you know, we have a budgeted number of a GA price that we're trying to get. Right, but when you're competing against reserve tickets that are well below our GA price, it's kind of hard to sell our GA ticket, right? So that's a challenge that we continue to have, and everybody continues to have that. So we're trying to do some unique things to limit the amount of brokers that are in our venues. We know who they are. Now it's our time to try to shrink their access to tickets. So we have some unique things that we can do in that realm.
You mentioned like K-State and how they had 10,000 donors and don't bring it as much, but where do we rank compared to like other Big 12 powers?
That's good. Like good question, because I meant to touch base on that. So we have, budget-wise, we are in our top 3 budget in the Big 12. And we do that without the football program that's blowing and going, right? We're getting there, but we're not blowing and going yet. When we get to 50,000 seats sold out, that number, could we take over Oklahoma? I don't know. We're kind of pretty solid, number 3. When it comes to number of donors, or number of dollars raised in our annual fund, we're number 3. When it comes to number of donors, we're on the backside. We're bottom 3 on number of donors. So our top 3 levels pay 90% of our revenue. So I hope that gives you some perspective. So we know, we get football going, we're going to drive our revenue, drive our budget, you know, get more people in the door to become donors. So that's where K-State beats us, right? So they got football going, so they throw in the amount of donors. Like, you know, what's crazy, and don't quote me, I should know this number, but don't quote me. Our football number on ticket sales, we bring in, you know, close to $4 million on ticket sales. Our football, basketball number is $13 million. Every other athletic department in the Big 12 is what? Flip-flopped. So if we can just get football going, man, sky's the roof for us. So we're excited about the possibility to get that going. So.
Could you explain why we lose $2 million when the Sugar Bowl goes to
national? Yeah. And I'm not really entangled in all that. I just get told we got to go raise $2 million. But I'll tell you this in layman terms. We get a conference split right, based on TV revenue. So if a team goes to a bowl, I think when we went to the Orange Bowl in 08, I think the conference office split like $18 million. Okay? So we have guaranteed bowls that we go to, and if a team makes it, they get a split, and then all this money goes to the pot, and they split that revenue out, okay, evenly. The team that's in it gets a little bit higher percentage, and then they split everything out, is the way I understand it. So when Sugar Bowl is hosting, that's one of our guaranteed bowls. So typically the winner of the conference will get a berth to the Sugar Bowl, which is a BCS game, right? Well, when they are the national championship, that's one less bowl that we can qualify for, unless we have a national champion playing for that. So, see what I'm saying? So we're getting less money because it's not a guaranteed game for us. So, it's a good question.
Two more questions for Matt.
I was gonna ask, like, you're talking about the football team, like, once they, like, you know, improve and stuff, like, bringing more money into the school and stuff. Just kind of take me through, like, at Wichita State, like, at a mid-major school, that doesn't have a football program, what, like how much money, like, they increased when they became kind of not a, like, maybe they'll make it this year, maybe they won't, to a, they're going to win every single year and make the tournament and be, like, a contender how they are now. Like, how much money for a team that doesn't have a football program does that raise for the athletic program?
Well, yeah, you can look at it in two different ways. Is you got a football program that costs a lot of money to operate, right? So, like Missouri Valley, when I was at Wichita State, we fully funded every sport, which means we fully fund every scholarship. We don't tell our coaches that they have to have X amount of in-state kids compared to out-of-state. If Greg Marshall or the golf team or whatever at Wichita State wanted to go get all international students, they could. That is part of the reason why they're leaving the Valley, is because they're not competing against teams that do that. So you're going up against Drake, and Illinois State's up there. Northern Iowa has a football program that's draining them, which is not fully funded. Their basketball program is the only sport that's fully funded in Northern Iowa. And so you're going up against that. So it costs a lot of money. You think 85 scholarships. You think, you know, they just had a cookout, you know, this week, and it costs a lot of money where they bring a guy in from Dragos from New Orleans. That costs a lot of money to do. Tutoring, all those things cost money. I mean, I can keep going and going and going on our football program and how much it drains. But then you look at returns on ticket sales and donations that come. So football, no question, drives the revenue nationwide, okay? Wichita State will likely, and they went through the scenario, and maybe I'm crazy, I don't think they're ever going to have football because it's very draining on an athletic department, right? There's very few athletic departments, and Dr. Baty should probably tell me better than anybody. There's only like 20 athletic departments in the whole country that operate in a surplus, that actually make money. We're one of them, okay? We're one of them. But it's not really designed to do that, to make money. You're designed to spend the money that you bring in. So football's draining on a small market budget. You see UAB that dropped football, what was that, 4 years ago they dropped football? Now they're trying to revive it and do all those things. It's very costly to do that. When Wichita State dropped it in the 80s, it was draining their athletic department. Lou Perkins comes in and cuts it, as he should have, because it was draining the athletic department. So, and now you see why it's draining the athletic department. Look what happened. And during that time when they dropped football, what are the two sports, revenue sports, that prevail in Wichita State? Basketball and baseball. Okay, they're getting 8,000 people at a baseball game. God, I'd kill for 8,000 people at our game, right? So we're not quite a revenue sport yet here, but Wichita State, they are. So hopefully that answered your question. I don't know all the dirty details on it, but got one more question? Yeah, ours is more driven around capital projects. So, for example, a $10 million gift that we get designed, we go ask for that money to name our volleyball facility, or go name our baseball facility, or go name those things, Memorial Stadium. That's where we really target. We do some recognition for our $50,000 donors and different levels. If you reached a different lifetime of giving, you know, you qualify for getting put on a, you know, a plaque on the wall. So it's really driven around capital on projects, getting your names. And the university operates that way as well. Naming buildings, it's all based on capital projects typically. So we're good. Well, I appreciate you guys allowing me to come in and talk. Hopefully you guys learned some stuff. If there's anything, I got my cards up here. I don't have enough, but you can get my contact information for Dr. Bass. I'll leave you with this. You guys read an article on conference realignment. I worked with Dan Beebe when I was an intern at the Big 12, and it's crazy right now. You know, it's really crazy of what's going to happen over the next 4 or 5 years in conference realignment. Does the Big 12 stay put? Do we add more teams? Do we lose teams? Those type of things, those things. So what's important? When you're talking about conference realignment, what do you think is our number one thing that we got to get going and producing? Football, right? So we can get football going, we can go sell out our venue and get football success. Guess what? If things were to happen in conference realignment, we're a lot more attractive to another conference if we get football going. Now, where's our home? Where do we want it to be? We want it to be the Big 12. But who do you think's driving that? Who's the two schools that are driving conference realignment in our conference?
Oklahoma and
Texas, right? They're driving that because they're the big money producers. Okay, so they're driving that. So if something was to happen with Big 12, we want to be in the best position to make sure that our student athletes and our fan base are operating at the BCS level. So we got to get football going, and we are. And that's why we're going to dump a lot of money into it over the next 1 or 2 years. Okay. All right. Thanks, everybody. I appreciate it.